All right, so the point of the first homework was we knew that if we had a lens and we learned that if I put an object a focal distance away and I look exactly a focal distance at the back focal plane, I get the perfect Fourier transform of this, let's say, transmission function, T of X and Y. So basically, question A of problem one was to kind of try to understand what happens if actually this is not where it's supposed to be, but actually shifted right against the lens right here. Yeah? So I'm not going to go through all the calculations. I want to just, so many of you got it right, but I want to just get the idea right, and I'm sure you can do the calculations yourself. So what do you expect is going to happen without any calculation? Like, do you have a feel for what? Do I get the Fourier transform? It's good to think of the problem before you start calculating anything. Like, what do you think is going to happen?
It's out of, well, if it was on the back at focal plane, right, it would have been a Fourier transform, so you can kind of think of it in time reverse and think of.
That's how I would do it. I think that's the best way to think about it. So because this thing is shifted by a distance f, maybe the best way to do it is to propagate it back with the Fresnel kernel. And then I know that that's going to be a Fourier transform. You see? So essentially, it will be, if I propagate it back over a distance f, it's going to be, so it's going to be t convolved with the Fresnel kernel, which is e to the I kx squared plus y squared over 2f, right? And basically, I take the Fourier transfer of this thing then. And pretty much that's the end of the problem. So what's going to happen? You are going to get the Fourier transform of the object, and this becomes a product. So you are going to get, so this is in the kx, ky. I put a tilde for the Fourier transform. This convolution becomes a product, and this will be e to the minus kx squared plus ky squared f at the top, and then 2 this k naught, right? Okay, over 2 k naught. That's it. So if you're an experimentalist and now you're doing a measurement on this thing, what does this little equation tell you? That I do get still something proportional to the Fourier transform, even though it's in the wrong place, except has this quadratic dish on top, right? So it's not perfect. But, for example, if I'm only doing intensity measurements, which is most commonly done, if I take the magnitude square of this, so in other words, if I measure at this plane and I only do intensity measurements, I don't even see this thing. Which is kind of interesting. Yeah? But if I look at the field clearly, this is gonna, for example, it's gonna mess up my image. So if I try to make a microscope, right? What do I do? I put another lens here, take this plane and Fourier transform it again. Right? Are you with me? So what's going to happen to your image? So I know if I had my object here, I would have gotten a perfect microscope image. Yeah? But now if I put the lens here and I Fourier transform this whole thing, not just that, this whole thing, what am I going to get? Convolution again, which means
you get blur.
This is out of focus. So basically, this is perfect. Instead of being an ideal in the ideal place here, where I get the crisp image, this thing is going to be blurred exactly by this Fresnel propagation. So it's going to be a terrible image. It's going to be blurred by the Fourier transform of this. Yeah. Everybody cool? that okay? Okay. So keep that in mind. Intensity versus field measurements, the intensity measurement cannot tell you where the object is. Is that kind of interesting? All right. Now, what if, okay, so enough of problem A. How about problem B? What if I place the object in a more, even more weird place? Behind the lens, right? And then I'm measuring still at the back focal plane of this lens. So we do what we always do. We propagate with the Fresnel kernel of a distance d. So convolution, multiplication, convolution over f minus d. That's pretty much it. It's not a very elegant result. It is what it is. So if you do it right, you get what Caitlin got, which is something with a Fourier transform where the frequencies have f minus d at the bottom. So they have this distance. So it's going to be u of x and y, something proportional to the Fourier transform of the object. K naught x over f minus d, k naught y over f minus d. And there are quadratic factors in front for the same reason as before, because the object is in the wrong place. So you get something like e to the I, k, x squared plus y squared, something like that, over f minus d. And the 2 somewhere. There we go. I think that's it. Okay, so this was just a simple calculation. So again, what we know, these type of problems, you can only do either convolution or multiplication. And the problem is the complication comes from the fact that you always get both. So when you reach the object or you reach the lens, you have to do a multiplication. So you propagate with the convolution, propagate over a Fresnel distance. Then you multiply and convolve again, multiply, convolve again. So that makes it a little bit messy, but I really appreciate it, or you get most of your points, or at least half of them, if you just show kind of the block diagram. So convolution from here to here, just symbolically, write that V circle, and then multiply, and then convolve again, multiply, convolve again. I'm pretty much happy with that. So this pretty much solves any problem. So you can get as complicated as you want with this. Any more questions about this? All right. Okay. So kind of along the same lines, but the question is slightly different now. What happens if... So again, we learned that if I have a plane wave illumination, and I illuminate my object that's F in front of the lens, and I'm looking at F behind the lens, I get my perfect Fourier transform. Question is now, what happens if my illumination is not a plane wave, but actually is a point source that is at a finite distance? So plane wave means my object is at infinity, roughly speaking. What if it's not at infinity, it's at a finite distance d? What's going to happen? So again, it will be kind of interesting to think about this before you start calculating. And okay, so if I have a plane wave incident, there will be light that goes through the object, unscattered, right? So that's the DC. And the lens is going to focus it down exactly at the back focal plane, right? So it kind of makes sense that where the light is focused becomes a Fourier plane, right? Because that DC gets focused in one point, meaning the zero frequency becomes the origin in this plane, right? So now, yeah, everybody okay with that? So now what happens? Where is that focal point when my source is a point source? It's no longer going to be focused at the back focal plane of this lens, right? But where is it? Yeah, so it's going to be where this point is actually imaged. That's where my DC will be placed. That, and therefore, that's where my Fourier plane will be placed. Right, Alex? So in a way, if you want to think another way about this, when I illuminate with a plane wave, my source is at infinity. The Fourier plane is going to be the image of that source, which is actually at, happens to be at the focal plane. The moment I bring the source from infinity to finite distances, the image of the point is going to slide away from the focal plane of the lens, right? And it's going to be exactly where this point is imaged. Okay? So you can use that kind of judgment to get the right answer by kind of by intuition, by thinking a little bit about it. And then if you do the calculation right, which is basically using the Fresnel approximation from here to here, convolution, multiplication, and then what I would do is to simply Fourier transform the whole thing. Yeah? So you can convolve, you get exactly a Fresnel kernel, multiply here, and you take the Fourier transform of the whole thing. And you are over here. But that's not what... You can do that, so you find the field here, but that's not very useful. What you want is, what's the distance z, let's say to here, where this is exactly a Fourier transform. Okay? So forget taking this Fourier transform, it's not very useful. Okay, so you take a Fresnel, multiply it, another Fresnel, multiply at the lens, and then take another Fresnel with an unknown distance z, and then you solve for z such that the result at this unknown plane becomes a Fourier transform of your object. Yeah? Right? So this is a little bit involved, but what you get actually is exactly what we anticipated, that that the Fourier plane is going to be the point where the plane where this point is actually imaged. So if you call, why did I put z there? Let's call this z. I made a mess. So it's going to be like this. 1 over f plus d. So basically the point source is f plus d distance in front of the lens, plus 1 over z, which is the distance behind the lens right here, equals 1 over f. That's what you're going to get out. And many of you didn't write it like this, but they got the correct result, which is z equals f 1 plus f over d, something like that. Okay, so notice if d is infinity, your z becomes f. So that's one quick check. Yeah? So if my point source now is at infinity, d is infinity, it means that I'm illuminating with a plane wave. So this term disappears, so I get the Fourier transforms right the focal distance behind the lens. Okay, any questions about this? Is that okay? All right. Moving right along. Here's what I thought was the easiest way to get points in this whole homework thing. But it didn't go as well for everybody. So Basically, this problem is about thinking in the frequency domain and try to get a quick feeling for an imaging system comparing frequency coverage of the condenser of your objective with respect to the frequency coverage of your object. So first of all, we assume your object is band limited, okay? Has a very kind of limited frequency coverage, the object itself. And the question was, if I have my, what we call the condenser aperture, meaning you can imagine this is an extended source that is cut by this aperture, and then I have the first lens that takes the Fourier transform of that onto the object, okay? So that gives me a frequency coverage by itself, a disk. And then I have a frequency coverage of the objective itself. So the objective takes this, makes another Fourier transform here. Yeah. And these two have a certain relationship with the frequency coverage of the object. The question was, what's the quality of my image? What's the resolution and contrast in these particular situations when I close down the condenser, meaning in the, bless you, in the picture right here, I close this down to make a point source, which means that L1 is going to Fourier transform that. It's going to give me actually plane wave, right? So that is the plane wave illumination of my object. Are you guys with me? So this is the plane wave illumination. My frequency domain of the illumination field is a delta function. Okay, only 1K. So you can visualize this like that. So this is my delta function. Okay. But now, the P3 is the object, right? Yeah. P2 is the objective. And this is my object. Okay, so how do you think about this? What's the resolution?
The figure after P1 is set up behind, I see the picture.
Sorry?
The figure,
all
the next time. So the first P1 is the lamp?
Right here,
right?
Yes.
Yeah, I thought this is after the lamp. So in question A, this is a delta function. I thought the incident line is the plane wave, I thought.
Yeah, it's equivalent to that. That's how you make a plane wave.
No, in this picture is the aperture of the L1. But I thought it's what it was the aperture of the source.
I'm not sure I understand. So if I make this a delta function, it means this aperture is closed to a pinhole.
Yeah, this delta function is K domain.
Yes.
If it's a K domain, the source will be a plane wave, but now it's a point source.
Oh, but this is in the Fourier plane of the object. You see, the object and that lamp are Fourier transform of each other, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So the illumination field in the spatial domain is here. The frequency domain of that illumination field is here. So this is the K domain, this is the spatial domain. So when I say delta of K perpendicular, it means is delta function here, which becomes a plane wave at the object plane. Was that confusing?
You're saying in frequency domain.
Yeah, I mean, how...
All the frequency has a point,
so
lamp,
and
so it's an object.
So
object.
What's the confusion? How can I be more clear than this? So delta of K perpendicular is the illumination field.
P1, PYTX, I thought is the frequency domain aperture at the lamp. But it's actually at the object. It's not.
Frequency domain at the,
see the picture.
Okay.
So the first one, so the delta function is a K domain.
Yeah.
I thought the beam here will be like this. I thought it's
Because it's delta k. So I thought the...
It should be delta x, y.
Yeah, so it should be delta x, y at this point.
No. X and y is at the object plane. Right?
But one thing we cannot define whether this is frequency domain, this is frequency plane, or this is position or spatial plane. I think every plane have spatial aperture and frequency aperture. So when you say P1, KX...
So how is this not confusing? Is this confusing that we call that K?
This K, I think, is just the...
That's okay?
That's a frequency aperture here.
The first column should have been X and Y.
Why?
Because we think you're limiting the K at the very length, so we think it's a plane where only one K can go through.
Yes.
Oh, I understand, but why would you think that? I mean, isn't it clear that this is the frequency domain? These two are frequency domains because this is my...
It's just because you labeled it X and Y. Like, I read it as X and Y, but I didn't even read it when doing the homework. I just did no a priori that usually you do the input lamp as a in space. You can input a delta.
So I have a question. This might
clear
up.
Right. Yeah. So your X domain, if you want to call it this X domain, you just need to do the conversion KX as X over lambda F1. And KY, the same thing. The reason I didn't think to clarify this further is because we always use this for the objective, right? And there is no way of comparing the three apertures unless you assume the object is in the spatial plane, right? How many people got confused about this? Half the class? All right. That means we need to regrade your things. So basically what you assumed is that my point source is here and I have another lens here, or somehow that the point source is there and this is a plane wave at the lamp plane?
Yeah.
Why?
Because the P1 is near the lamp, and so it's a kind of translation function of the lamp. So it's a delta function.
Let me read the problem again. This problem was written on the airport, by the way. At the airport, not on the airport. At the airport. So, an ECE plane wave projected onto the object by the condenser, lens L1. The microscope objective L2 collects blah, 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 L3 blah, blah, blah. Let P1 be the condenser aperture. Okay, so you thought P1 of X and Y. Come on, but this is pointing at P of KX, KY. What's the problem?
Well, if it's a delta in KX and KY, then that means you have a plane wave, right?
What?
Yeah, because you put KX, you should have used X and Y. Because if it was just X and Y, then it would be consistent.
No. What? I want this to be delta of KX and Y. I want to make this a point. That's why I wrote it in KX, KY. And the conversion to actually X coordinate, if you want, is this. And I assume everybody knows that. Right?
The X is at the lamp plane or the objective plane? The X.
Lamp.
KX.
Okay, I can write an X everywhere. So X here, X here, X here, everywhere. But the moment I wrote it P of KX, KY, you have to remember what that means in terms of, so higher frequency means higher X this way, right? And the conversion is this, X over lambda F. So this is clear. You never question this one, right? Why? If you're confused about this, why aren't you confused about that?
I think when you write a T, we just assume that it's a T at that point without doing a Fourier transform of the lens. But when you write P1, you are assuming that that's the Fourier transform of the lens. The Fourier transform
No, I understand. I understand, and that is fair. But why are you not thinking the same way here? It's because we saw it before.
Because there's like an aperture function that just multiply the field there.
Yeah. So is this. Anyway, okay. So let's not drag this too long. So I think I kind of agree that this should have been a little bit more clear. So. How about this? If you feel your score was impacted because of this confusion, at the office hours, bring your exam and we'll regrade it. You may get a lower grade, but... Is that fair? Yes? Okay. But congratulations to those who didn't get confused. Okay, so... all right. So this is frequency, everything here is frequency domain. That was the whole point of the problem. So if this is a point source, that means the condenser aperture is closed down. The illumination at the object becomes a plane wave. And basically, in point A, you see that the frequency coverage of your objective matches perfectly the frequency coverage of your object. And basically, the question was to just state that you can recover your object perfectly. That was my expected answer. And I wanted you to comment on the contrast. That wasn't accidental that I asked about contrast. Some people completely ignore, like they didn't even write the word contrast on the homework. And I wanted you to write down, well, I didn't say whether the object was phase object or not, I don't think, but you should have written, if this is a phase object, it looks like this, e to the I, blah, blah, blah. Magnitude square of that gives you zero contrast. That's the kind of thing I was expecting. But of course, if your object is amplitude object, then you get high contrast. OK, so point B, which is contrasting with point C later, the contrast question. Point B, you see the same thing, plane wave illumination. This is my objective. But now the object has a coverage that's twice that of the objective, and I was expecting you to say, well, my object is, I lose information, I lose high frequency details from the object. And the contrast is the same. Now, this is structured illumination, as we discussed before. So I have two point sources illuminating at an angle. Again, this is frequency domain. At the object plane, I get the sinusoid. What happens to the resolution? Well, I can fit higher frequencies in my objective, right? Because my spectrum is essentially shifted. We discussed this in our lectures a long time ago. So I expect my resolution to go up, right? And essentially, because these two are equal disks, basically my DC is on the border of the aperture of the objective, which is basically a dark field, borderline dark field illumination. Okay, so the DC basically kind of falls in here, and each will have a disk. You remember this picture we did last time? So this one has a disk. So the radius of the new disk is now twice the original radius of my objective. That's why I can fit higher frequencies into my system. And also, if these are identical, the two things, I basically miss some of the DC. So the contrast is also expected to go up, even if you look at the purely phase object. Okay, it is a dark field or borderline dark field illumination. So keep in mind, the reason we don't get much contrast for phase objects is because you get this strong DC that fills up your detector. So in this, shifting the DC to the edge of your frequency coverage, you essentially remove it. Is that okay? You look really upset about the whole thing.
Can you draw a picture about how the light propagates?
I can. Actually, I can. Should I make a new one? Let's make a new one. So, I have two dots, two point sources. Then I have the condenser lens, let's call it CL, okay? And then this is focal distance of the condenser, and this is where I put my object, right? Yep. And this is FC. Now, each point source gives you basically a plane wave, like that. Approximation. This other point gives you another plane wave that is actually like this, right? And all together, when they mix up, they give you a sinusoid. They give you fringes, right? That's what happens. This is a Young interferometer, right? Two slits. Boop. Yeah? Now, I have my objective right here. That will take a point source from my object. This will be the Fourier plane of my objective. This will be the Fourier plane of the object, the Fourier focal distance of the objective. Okay. And now I have finally a tube lens, which has FDL, FDL. So basically one point from the object is going to be focused down right here, and that's where the image plane is going to be formed. Right? If I take another point over here and I propagate, it's going to be probably imaged here. This is the frequency coverage of the objective. Okay? So maybe, is this okay? Or should we draw some more? Is it clear why when I shift the point source up, I gain frequency coverage? Is that clear to everybody? It is? So what exactly happens compared to a point source on axis? Why is this giving me higher frequencies from the object? How do you think about it?
You can imagine a cosine will give you two orders going that way. So if you shift everything, you get one of the orders to come in.
Right. Exactly. So it's basically the shift theorem. You're shifting the spectrum. If this is the objective, whatever we call P2, and this is in the K-perpendicular domain. By the way, if I put a tilde on my P before, would you have been less confused? Would that have made it clear that we're in the frequency domain?
Yes, well, for me, yeah.
Yeah? So tilde, okay.
So the P2 and P3 in the frequency domain is in the same plane, right? It's part of the same plane?
Same domain, yeah. What do you mean same plane?
Same plane, the P2 and P3. P2 is people with an object.
I mean, they're clearly not in the same plane, right? But they're in the same domain.
Yes.
So they are apples to apples. But one is, of course, here. The other one is here. Is that what you mean?
P2 and P3.
P3 is of the power spectrum of the object.
Yes.
Right? So I don't even know where to put that. It's kind of an abstract thing. Right? But they're in the same domain. So one frequency K perpendicular They're in the same K perpendicular coordinate system. Is that what you're asking?
So P3 will limit the light incident from it?
No, P3 is the object, isn't it?
Yeah. It's the other way around, yeah. P2 would limit what P3 could have been.
Yes. So P2 is the objective. So it's kind of like this. This is my objective. And the object could be smaller or bigger, right? So if it's bigger, clearly this is going to chop it off. So the objective is going to remove frequencies. It's going to low-pass filter your object, right? So let's clarify this thing. They're physically different apertures. They could be anywhere in your optical, on your optical axis. But when you bring them in the frequency domain, you can actually compare them. That's the beauty of the frequency domain. They're not physically overlapped, right? Because, for example, so the Zs could be different, Z1, Z2, Z3.
You can say P3 is just a Fourier transform of your object.
It's already there, yeah. So I don't even know where to place the P3, right? It doesn't have a physical location.
But it will limit the light angle is it from it.
P2 will. P3 was just put in there as a concept so you can compare.
So P3 is the frequency content of your object.
Yeah, I know.
Okay.
Which is the pupil function.
Okay. No, it's not a pupil function. This is a property of the object. Forget all the optics, not dependent on the optics, right? It's a property of the object. Imagine, I don't know, I have a grating, okay? Or a bunch of gratings overlapped. The highest frequency has a hard stop, okay, within this disk. Without any relation to the optics that you use. Okay? So now I'm trying to image this object with my microscope. And if I do a good job, I'm recovering the highest frequency, meaning, and that happens only when the pupil of my objective is larger than the frequency content, right? The moment that is smaller, then I'm cutting down on the frequency. So I will low pass filter the object. Okay.
So the picture represents the highest frequency the object.
Yes. Yeah. Or the domain coverage. This is the domain, right? You can find an object that has this frequency coverage. Who knows, right? Whatever. It's a property of the object. But this problem was about how my imaging system performs with respect to now the frequency coverage of my system or the transfer function of my system, which is given by the pupil of the objective. So how these two kind of compare. So now here, going back to the previous discussion, here we are trying to understand why is this better from the frequency point of view that my sources are shifted. And Daniel said it's because of essentially of the shift theorem. So you're shifting the, if this was your objective, or P2, I'm essentially shifting my illumination here. And then what's the highest frequency I can fit through my objective at this point? It's going to be this much. This will be Kmax, because this is shifted to the edge of my objective pupil. If I'm in the center with the point source on axis, I only fit this much. This is the highest frequency. That's the reason. Okay, if you want more a spatial domain picture, although the problem was about forcing you to think in the frequency domain. So in the spatial domain, or in a domain that we're familiar with, it's kind of like this. Okay, this is my object. This is my objective. And I have a cutoff frequency that is this big. And remember, that frequency is related to this angle theta, right? So yeah, so this is the highest angle, theta max. Now, if I shift this over here, no, this is not a good picture. Let me start again. So this is my ponton axis. I have to put the condenser first. Okay? And now here's my object, T. Okay? So this is the K incident. Now I have the objective here. This is my theta max. When the illumination is a plane wave on axis. Yeah? The moment I'm shifting this over here, I create a plane wave that I drew earlier. Maybe I should use a different color. Maybe that will help. Okay? So this is now off axis. My plane wave is shifting this way now. Okay? So let me translate this over here. So my incident K vector is this way. Therefore, the maximum angle I can fit in the objective is now this much. Is two times the theta max. Is that helping? So basically my DC, which is always the incident light, my DC is shifted angle-wise, which means it's shifted in the frequency domain. That's why we're plotting it like this in the frequency domain. The DC from the origin is shifted at the edge right there. So you fit a double angle into your objective, which is from here all the way to here. So two ways to look at this. Is that okay?
Yeah, a question about that.
Yeah.
So what happens once we take the Fourier transform of that and try to get an image? So if you have two orders coming out and you reconstruct that through your imaging system, mm-hmm. those two orders interfere and give you back your cosine, and that's the point of imaging.
Yeah.
But in this case, one of those is getting thrown out and only one of them is entering the objective. What is it going to interfere with to get you back the cosine on the other side?
Well, in this particular problem, actually, none of them disappears. They are at the edge, both of them. So you still get your sinusoid back. Is that what you're asking?
Two of them, okay.
Yeah, I have two of them. So basically, if you get your sinusoid here, a perfect imaging system, which will give you exactly the same sinusoid with the higher frequencies from the object. A pure dark field illumination will be when these are shifted all the way up here, and your DC is actually missing out entirely. So imagine your DC now is this way, is missing your objective. In that case, you do not have any transmitted light interfered. So there is no incident light giving you the cosine. Not only that, if I take out the object, you get dark. You get nothing. You still don't have access to the OneNote? I assume you're not taking pictures of me, but of the notes. You guys have access to this or no? Yeah? Okay. So that's why we call it dark field. Remember that in the absence of object, I get dark. So this was basically the contrast question. So the first two problems were, if I have a phase object, the first two geometries really don't help me with the contrast at all. Okay. This gives me perfect resolution from the object. This blurs the object, but the contrast is equally bad if I have a transparent object. In this case, the contrast gets good because of the off-axis illumination. All right? Yeah? Yes? Sure, but who cares? What would you do if you get the sinusoid? Locking amplifier. In the spatial domain. No, that's very interesting what he said. So you using? Did you use locking amplifiers in time domain? Everybody, do you know how the locking amplifier works?
We find the frequency that's trapped, propagate, and try to subtract the amplitude only.
Right. Okay, so the locking amplifier is this device that is basically is locking into a certain frequency of your signal. So imagine you have a noisy, very noisy signal, usually in time domain. And it allows you to extract very high signal to noise, a particular frequency from your signal that you know you put it there, right? So the way it works is actually exactly like this. You multiply your signal. So you have, imagine, S of T. And you multiply it with a cosine of, I don't know, omega T, which you know is your frequency of interest. So you're looking for the amplitude and phase of this particular signal, of this harmonic that is buried into this noisy signal. So what happens is, if you take the Fourier transform of this, if you look in the frequency domain, this is going to give you what? Two shifted frequencies, right? So it's going to give you S of omega minus capital omega plus S of omega plus omega, right? This is our, small omega. So this is our modulation theorem, or the shift theorem, right? Right? But now, in the locking amplifier, is look at the DC component. So you filter, so imagine your signal looks like this, Fourier transform, whatever, looks like that. But when you multiply it with the cosine, actually starts to look like this, where this is omega, this is minus omega. And now you put a bandpass filter that is exactly at zero. And what's that going to measure? It's going to measure the wings of the signal that actually spill into the origin, which is exactly the omega frequency that you're looking for. Are you with me? So I multiply with the sinusoid that I'm looking for, and then I bypass at origin. But now the new origin corresponds to the exactly to the omega frequency because I shifted it by omega, capital omega. Anyway, so that's how the locking amplifier, essentially it's averaging very well the signal, bandpassing that around the frequency of interest, and this is, you can get incredible signal to noise. And it's true, this is exactly that in the spatial domain. And I have a personal story about that, actually. We developed a microscope based on it. Once I understood how the locking amplifier works, I said, how can we do this in the spatial domain? And that's how we came up with diffraction phase microscopy a long time ago, where we actually, I put the grating here. Instead of using two beams like that, I put the grating right smack in the image plane, which is the same idea, right, as the locking amplifier. Okay, so good connection, but now what about it? What about the locking amplifier? What do we do with the sinusoid? So I put the sinusoid in, my objective does a good job, I magnify the sinusoid maybe, and then the question was how do I get rid of it, right? Because it's not part of my image, right? So what would you do? Homework three. There we go. Yeah, homework three. You just filter it out. Right? If you take the Fourier transform of that, it's going to give you... So basically you get the transmission of x and y times the cosine of, I don't know, x over lambda, y and y. So sinusoid only one axis. Fourier transform of, or let's call it beta x. So the Fourier transform of that is going to be along kx. It's going to be your object here, shifted by beta, by your modulation frequency. The way we designed the problem was that actually these are touching in the origin. So the two point sources are shifted at the edge of the frequency of the pupil, right? So technically it will be more like this. So what do you do? Just cut this off, shifted in the center, no information loss. So you remove the carrier or you demodulate it. Okay, no problem. Okay, good. All right. Problem four, D. Same as C, but now B, the radius of this thing goes to zero. Some people had trouble with this. Why? What does this mean? This is my objective, right? It's a terrible objective. Numerical aperture is zero, right? You guys know what that this is actually the numerical aperture right in here, right? So this is k naught sine of theta or k naught na for the objective. That's the meaning of that radius. The higher the angle, the higher the radius, right? So now question D is about closing that angle down to zero. So B equals zero, terrible objective. It has a pinhole basically in the back focal plane. That's how you could think about it. Like, you close this baby down now. So what's going to happen? What's the resolution of that thing? Zero. Terrible resolution. Or we should say infinite resolution, right? Because resolution is the smaller the better. That's always kind of confusing. No resolution. Yeah, you're just passing the DC. Or if you illuminate with off axis, it's not a DC, right? What do you get? Huh?
Fringes.
Really?
Just one high frequency.
One high frequency. No more fringes, I don't think. Yeah. Oh, you get fringes at the sample plane, but then once the objective passes those, it only passes one KZ component. Okay, so. All right, we're here, right? So now imagine I'm closing this down to a very tight pinhole. Yeah? So I get my fringes here as usual, but now I only fit through these k vectors. No spread at all. This will not make it, this will not make it. Terrible resolution. Only one frequency. Because it's off-axis illumination, my frequency is not DC. It's actually this kind of frequency. It's this illumination, this will be my DC over here, and I'm getting exactly that frequency in. Half the maximum frequency. But still, if you pass only one frequency, your imaging system essentially has zero resolution. Resolution is about the bandwidth.
What's the difference between that and Compoval? It's just that's a pinhole in space, not in.
Yes, somebody, was it you who talked about the confocal?
Yeah, I think I got confused with that.
Yeah, I thought so. Yes, confocal microscopy, which we are going to talk about next, you have your pinhole in the spatial domain. So since you brought it up, let's talk about it. So imagine the difference between a pinhole placed in the frequency domain. How should I emphasize that we are in the frequency domain? Tilde. Cool. Now, imagine I'm putting a pinhole in the spatial domain. And I'm scanning the object or something. Okay? What's the difference? I should give you some context. I'm trying to image a thick thing. Okay? So, confocal is usually done with the focused light, but you can think of a spinning disc confocal where, let's say, it's illuminated by a full field, by a plane wave, okay? So now, if my objective sits right here, there is a depth of focus of some sort, like you can think of the Rayleigh parameter in the Gaussian beams, for example, if my light was focused down. But the problem is that I always get this out-of-focus light from here, they all fit into my objective. There's nothing that prevents that out-of-focus light to get into my optics, right? But now, if, I don't know, I use another lens and I image that point down, imagine here I have a pinhole. Okay, so now let's take this point, autofocused. Where is this one going to be focused by the whole imaging system? I don't know, somewhere here, let's say. If my pinhole is tight enough, the light that makes this point is going to mostly hit the mount of the pinhole, is not going to go through. Only very little goes through. So most of the light is going to be matched at the plane of the pinhole, from this plane to that plane. Anything in between that's focused down here is going to look like that. So this light is blocked. This light is blocked. If it's focused behind the pinhole, this light is going to be blocked, and that light is going to be blocked. So in fact, putting the pinhole in the sample plane or in the image plane helps. While putting a pinhole in the frequency domain totally messes up your resolution. Okay? So the opposite effects, as you might expect, whenever you go from spatial domain to the Fourier domain, things are upside down, right? Okay? All right. Okay, and this is for fun. I wanted you to just use your intuition and comment freely on these things. So what do you think this is relevant for? This is actually the aperture, the illumination on all phase contrast microscopes that are in use today, that are sold commercially by all the microscopy companies. It is not. When we did the calculation for phase contrast, we assumed there was a plane wave illumination, and the physics is the same. Whether you illuminate over a ring or you illuminate over a plane wave is kind of the same thing. So we didn't bother with the ring. But actually, using a ring illumination gives you some benefits. That's the reason the companies chose to use it like that. So one benefit is that if you look in the cross-section, you get this picture. This picture. Right? So this is a ring, if you like, in the cross-section. So what's the benefit we just discussed? What do we get? We get greater frequency coverage, just because I'm shifting my illumination of axis. And then there's another practical practical reason why this ring is useful and people, the major companies decide to go with the ring illumination is that usually you want to do other kinds of imaging, in particular fluorescence. And actually, if you design it carefully, your fluorescence can fit through this pupil, or let's move over here. If this is your ring illumination somewhere here, your fluorescence can go through without being blocked, physically blocked by that attenuator. So you remember in the phase contrast, you have a phase shifting, pi over 2, but you also have an attenuation to balance the two, the unscattered versus scattered light. Remember how that phase contrast works? It's going to be on the exam. So if you move it off axis, then my fluorescence can go through unattenuated. Sometimes you really starve for photons when you do fluorescence imaging. So that's another reason why this ring illumination is very practical and it became standard. All right, any Other questions about this? Nothing? Okay, let me ask you a question then. What is the difference? Okay, let me draw another one. What's the difference between this is my condenser aperture illuminated by a plane wave versus condenser aperture with the filament? This is an incandescent lamp. And everything the same. Condenser, my object. And then objective, the usual. The only difference between these two is that in the first case, and by the way, this is what I call P1 tilde, and the same thing, P1 tilde of K perpendicular. The difference is I'm illuminating this. This is a physical aperture, right, of a certain diameter. I'm illuminating it with a plane wave versus I have a emitting object pretty much like this one, and I aperture that. So this is a filament that emits light, and I have the same aperture. What's the difference at the sample plane, let's say? Yeah, so we're talking about the illumination field. How is the illumination field different at this plane between the two cases, if any? What? Won't be uniform? What do you mean?
Like you won't get a collimated beam through your sample?
Collimated beam. Which one gives me a collimated beam?
The plane wave.
So let's call it 1 and 2. Plane wave gives me a collimated beam?
I mean, if it's like delta.
Yeah, it's not a delta. Let me put it this way. If it's a delta, you won't be able to tell the difference, actually. So if I close these down, they become point sources. They become identical, OK? Let me put that out. The interesting thing is when you open it up.
Number one's going to give you something that looks like a string, so you're going to have fringes on top of your sample. And number two, you have independent.
Okay, and what's that going to give me?
The
image of the filament, really? My filament is here.
The direct opposite of the image.
The what?
It should be like, the point is that it should be like perfectly out of focus. You're trying to perfectly out of focus the image of the filament so it doesn't get overlaid on top of your...
You mean color illumination?
Yeah, color illumination.
Okay. Okay, so this is the difference. The difference. This is a plane wave. All the points on that plane wave, by definition, are in phase. Perfectly coherent. And this is a disk. The Fourier transform of a disk is going to be whatever, jink. Now, on the lamp case, I have these points across the lamp that have nothing to do with one another. They're really fluorophores that are independent. They're incoherent. Their phase information is not, there's no relation from point to point. Meaning that, let's say this point source right here is going to give me a plane wave. This point source right here is going to give me another plane wave. And another plane wave, without relationship between the two. So in one case, I have the field at the illumination at the sample of x and y. will be, in both cases, it will be P of K perpendicular tilde, E to the I, K perpendicular, R perpendicular, D to K perpendicular. Yeah? The difference will be that number one, so this applies to both. It's a summation of all these plane waves. Same thing here. This is a plane wave. This is another plane wave, and so on and so on. The only difference is that in the number one case, I have P of K, which is complex, as an amplitude of K, E to the I, phi of K, perpendicular. In the second case, I have the exact same thing, P of K perpendicular equals A of K perpendicular times E to the I, and I'm going to write it like this. Curly brackets. This is random. This is not. So I wanted to go back when we introduced the Fourier transform and I gave you that, the superposition picture that was saying basically the signal in the spatial domain is nothing more but the superposition of these sinusoids with the proper amplitude and proper phase. And the difference between case one and case two is this, that in case one, the coherent case, these are aligned very well. If I do a good job, I have no aberrations. They're all aligned, so they give you a maximum in the center. In case two, they're shifted randomly left and right. Oh man, that's the sinusoid. And how is it going to look like? It's going to look random. So the coherent case is going to give you focused light. This is going to give you speckle light. By speckle, we mean exactly this random distribution of maxima and minima, assuming the light is monochromatic, 1 omega. If you look at this light, case 2 applies, the incoherent case applies, if I look at this light. The reason I don't see speckles is why? Because I don't. If you compare this with the laser pointer on the wall, you'll see the difference.
It's not monochromatic.
It's not monochromatic. So basically, each color will give you a different speckle pattern. Independent. Only God can do random stuff, I think. You know what I mean. Let me do another color, green. You add them all up, they become uniform. You can never remove the speckle at a certain plane. The best you can do is to actually add more speckle that is independent, meaning averaging them out. Very, very important. But I want you to appreciate this, that the only difference between a focus beam, tightly focused beam, in this case a jink, and a uniform distribution of light is in the spectral phase, is in the phase distribution of each plane wave that makes my field here. So this will be a plane wave going this way, then another plane wave going that this way. In case one, they are connected, they are coming from the same plane wave, they're in phase. In the second case, they come from different the emission points, no correlation between the two. The outcome, completely different.
So why would you put that filament there?
Why would I put the filament there? As opposed to the plane wave? Well, because that's how the microscopes work, actually. Most of the commercial microscopes work like this, not like that.
So they only use spectral images?
If you use wide light, they don't. So in fact, most of the common transmission microscope, phase contrast, DIC, all of them use this with wide light. This is actually annoying. The coherence. So we love lasers and we love the coherence sometimes, right? We measure gravitational waves, we measure ether, whatever. But for imaging, not so great. They give you a lot of issues. Here's another interesting thing. What's the correlation? So let's call it, we call it US in both cases, right? So what's the 1 versus 2 in terms of US correlated with itself? So I'm talking about the field at the sample plane. What is the spatial correlation of that field between coherent and incoherent case? So we can call it coherent and incoherent. Who said?
Same.
Why? That's exactly right. The Fourier transform of this correlation is nothing more but US, yeah? Is the power spectrum, which means it's US of k perpendicular, e to the I, phi of k perpendicular, magnitude square, so this doesn't matter. Isn't that cool? So basically, the conclusion of this whole discussion is that confocal microscopy, which is this case, where basically you open up this aperture, you illuminate with a plane wave, you focus the light down to a point, you get your jink that we just discussed, and incoherent illumination with the same aperture will give you the same resolution. Because you have the same power spectrum. This aperture is exactly the same. So that frequency increase by illuminating at these steep angles, right, and fitting more frequencies. So let's say I take this edge and I fit this much in my objective. It's the exact same gain as in the incoherent case. I made a mess, but okay. So this increased frequency coverage is exactly the same in confocal versus incoherent. Because the power spectrum is the same. What's happening to our pizza?
So, then what's the benefit of using complementary?
That's a dedicated student right there. Ignores the pizza question. Very good, Alex. What do you think?
Does your cell phone have signal?
There's no signal?
Yeah.
I have signal, I got no... Maybe we should check outside. So, Alex, what do you think? What's the difference? No smell, nothing. So you asked a very good question. Then why do we bother with this confocal, right? Basically, that's what you said.
We only illuminate one frequency at a time with the confocal, but...
Why? Why do you say that? I focused... This is a confocal, right? I focus this into a point, and I get a bunch of frequencies out from the objective. You get one point at a time. Is that what you meant?
Yes.
One point at a time. So I need to scan either the beam or the object around. Okay, but still, why would I do that when I can do this? Which is basically, think about this. We can talk about this for a long time. Very, very basic things, right? It's as if the speckle pattern is illuminating your sample. It's like a confocal, except each speckle is the beam of your confocal. You illuminate with a bunch of confocal beams at the same time. Right? So if I were to image the speckle pattern here, what it looks like is something like this. Man, even my pen is hungry or something. Right? So you get maxima and minima and maxima and minima, I mean something like that. Random distribution. It's as if there's a bunch of spots at the same time illuminating the sample. You get the simultaneous image, no scanning needed, same resolution. Why do we bother with confocal?
Because it reflects out of light.
Because of that pinhole. When you put that pinhole that matches the focus beam here, you don't get a lot of benefit in X and Y. You get the benefit in Z. So all that out of focus light, when you do full field illumination, it's all coming at your detector. It's not filtered at all. Right? So if this was a much thicker object, you'll get light from everywhere propagating at your detector. There's no filtering going on. By doing it point by point, you are able to actually filter all that, or most of it, most of the light that is from out of focus planes. So confocal is still useful.
What does the cross correlation have to do with it? How does that?
It's the power spectrum.
The power spectrum.
So the frequency coverage of the illumination, right?
Okay.
Yeah. And again, I think I made this point before, but just so we close it up and hopefully Papa John's is on its way. Exact same theory applies to pulsed lasers versus CW. Yeah? CW, random phase distribution at each omega. I add all the omegas up. If they're not correlated in any way, if the modes are not locked, you get CW, except now. So this is a time axis now. When I put in the effort to align all the omegas together, I get a nice tight pulse, and that's why we call it that's not Papa John's. When I put in the effort to actually align all the modes to basically mode lock them, that's why we call it mode locking, you get the tightest possible beam. So pulse versus speckle. How is it looking out there? Really? Okay, well, let's take a break nevertheless. And let me call them. Okay, so we started with the approximation that gives us Gaussian beams. We kind of revisited the Fresnel approximation. I used the opportunity to kind of calculate them in cylindrical coordinates, and then no matter how you generate your Gaussian beam, what we're trying to find is how this beam transforms as it propagates through different optical components, essentially lenses and free space. And we found some interesting transformations that the Gaussian beam, as you propagate in free space, remains Gaussian in amplitude and in phase. Okay, so this is the phase term that comes e to the I phi. It's as usual, you have a plane wave, e to the I k naught z, that propagates. It's kind of the DC part of the beam, if you want. And on top of that, you have the curvature, either converging or diverging. So it's this part right here. But then the most interesting stuff that we found is that you have this weird phase term that is kind of arctangent of z over z naught, which is called Gui phase. It's a 100-year-old kind of discovery, more than 100 years old, that tells us that as we go, if I focus the beam down, let's say the beam is focused like this, if I plot that Gui phase, I get the transition from minus pi over 2 to pi over 2, a shift of pi as I go through focus, which puzzled people for a long time. And people are still publishing on this Gui phase stuff as a very esoteric thing. But I tried to explain last time that basically the meaning of this phase is that the reason it has to be there is to compensate for the fact that as your beam is no longer a flat plane wave, it has some curvature, you look at the phase along z that essentially does not have a frequency k naught, omega over c, but actually has a projection onto z of these off-axis angles, if you want. Okay, let me put it another way. If you have an angle, a k vector at a certain angle with respect to the optical axis, the phase along z is actually just the projection of that, which is k naught cosine of theta. So Gaussian beam has a distribution of these things. It's a small angle approximation, so the angles are small. But still, it's no longer just k naught, which is the wave number for a plane wave. It's actually k naught cosine of theta. And essentially, that Gui phase is averaging over all these z components. It's compensating for that. Okay? And what we found is actually that the phase velocity is slightly higher than the speed of light in vacuum, just because the wave number is no longer, so the phase velocity is no longer omega over k naught, it's omega over k effective, and that k effective is slightly shorter. Okay? All right. Well, you may not care too much about this when you do confocal microscopy, but I think it's interesting, or you should know what it's all about. All right, so here's something that we use all the time in practice, and that is the beam waist, W. And this is something to do with the width. If you take a cross-section of the beam propagating, let's say, along this axis, take a cross-section, W is something to do with the width of that Gaussian. And it's growing from the minimum waist, right, at the plane of focus, is growing in this form. So W will be W naught square root of 1 plus Z over Z naught. And Z naught is what we call a Rayleigh range. It tells you the distance over which this W grows to W naught square root of 2. This will be Z naught. Yeah? Then, in addition to W naught, we want to know the radius of curvature of this wavefront. And the interesting thing is, because we're no longer in the geometrical optics approximation, we're kind of taking into account the wave nature of light, meaning that this is not a point, the focal plane. The light is not focused to a point, it's actually focused to something that is of a finite width. It means that the radius, the center with respect to which the radius is calculated is actually not at the center of the focal plane, but slightly below, slightly behind. And the radius also looks like this. It has a dependence kind of similar to the W, except he is reversed, Z naught over Z. With these two, with the W defined, and if we go far away from that focal point, we can define a diffraction angle, which is something that we use very commonly in practice, right? You have a laser beam, you always ask, what's the divergence? That's what we mean, that theta. Okay, so theta is well defined only in far away from the focal point. And it's really W over Z. And I gave you a kind of an intuitive picture it's basically doing a small angle approximation, right? Just kind of W over Z. Okay? What else? So pretty much with two numbers, if you have the W and the radius, you define your beam, your Gaussian beam perfectly. It is only true because we approximated it to be a Gaussian. Can you imagine, right? An arbitrary distributional field, you need a lot more numbers to characterize it. So if we only need two numbers to define the Gaussian beam, the question is, can we come up with a formalism that will convert those two numbers as we propagate along an arbitrary optical system. So what we did was to look at the same ABCD matrices that are used in geometrical optics to compute rays, the angle of the ray, and the intercept of y, so the particular plane you define how far it is from the optical axis and what's the angle with respect to horizontal. And we found that if I propagate in free space, I guess this matrix number one that has the translation on the B position of the element, of the matrix element. If I have a dielectric interface where I have refraction, I have N1 over N2 at the bottom right, okay? And then we found one for the lens, which has the focal distance on the bottom left corner, so that's the C position. And basically, if I have these matrices, I can compute the angle and the elevation of a ray from an arbitrary point, from an arbitrary plane before an optical system to an arbitrary plane after. All I need to be careful about is how I multiply those matrices. And the way I want you to remember is a chronological order. Whatever happens first to the ray, that is what multiplies your input vector first. And it looks a little weird. It looks as if you're multiplying them in the wrong order, because you're starting here. But when I put my input vector right here, this is what happens first. So that will be the first component to the left. You look very excited. She was like this, come on. Good thing we didn't get dessert. Okay, so what is this to do with my Gaussian beams? It turns out that the same matrix applies to transform the properties of a Gaussian beam. And it's not so surprising because both of them are small angle approximation. Okay? So the way we're going to use this is by defining a complex beam parameter Q, which is defined as 1 over Q equals 1 over R minus I lambda over PW squared. Okay, so this is kind of the, if you like, the area of the beam, lambda. And Q is a complex number, therefore it has two dimensions, basically. And once I compute the matrix for a particular optical system, the Gaussian beam will be transformed with this simple formula. So Q2, which has both radius and waist, beam waist in it, will be AQ1, where Q1 is the input, plus B over CQ1 plus D. So that's it. So with this little formula now, you're able to transform pretty much any input Gaussian beam, obtain the output to essentially an arbitrary optical system, no matter how many lenses and surfaces and so on, and distances. So that was the kind of the main goal here. So with this example, we looked at a simple situation where we had, we're constrained, I think, by this distance. So we said, from the input to the output, I want that to be 1 meter. The Gaussian beam has this much divergence angle. And what helps a lot is that this is the minimum beam waist input, minimum beam waist out, so focus to focus. So that makes the radius go to infinity, so when you define the Q parameter, basically becomes easy, so this term disappears. So you compute the matrix, translation, lens matrix, another translation, you combine the two, and you end up with this matrix. And we talked about the element up here. Do you remember the relevance of that element? Anybody?
Imaging condition.
So basically, if I take a focal plane and I want to focus that beam down, I think the question was shrinking by a factor of 2. That is an imaging geometry. I take a focal plane and I image it down to another focal plane. And we looked at this last time and we explained why if I'm in the image plane, or if the two planes are conjugate, input versus output, then B has to be identically 0. So keep in mind, this matrix formalism applies to any rays coming from anywhere, not just image plane or conjugate planes. Could be anywhere, out of focus planes, arbitrary planes. The condition for imaging is that this element B is identical to zero, meaning that at the image plane, doesn't matter the angle of incidence, this, it will focus to one point. So it means Y is not a function of theta prime. That's the imaging condition. So that only happens when B is identical to zero. And this gives us the lens lens equation, which is this. OK, so you calculated the matrix. Then you do your little kind of transfer matrix between Q1 and Q2, and you get the solution that. I don't know. You have to place your lens somewhere. Anyway, you get your solution. Like, okay. And the focal distance is that. Okay? Do you have any questions about Gaussian beams? No. You mean if it's biconvex? No. And the reason is that we're under small angle approximation. So all these aberrations or, you know, subtle differences between different types of lenses, we're not looking at those. So as long as you have a focal distance f, it doesn't matter how the lens is within this approximation. Other questions? So basically, Gaussian beams are used in many applications, but relevant to this course, confocal microscopy. So we're going to look quickly at confocal microscopy. There isn't too much to talk about that. And then we're going to spend more time on OCT. Okay. So actually, we already discussed a little bit confocal versus full field illumination just a few minutes ago. So this was developed, I think I have a figure here. There we go. There's a patent from 1957 by Minsky. And I think it's an interesting story. He is more famous for computer science, artificial intelligence, than anything else. But in his spare time, he invented confocal microscopy, I guess. So another interesting thing is that this is a very old, I mean, it's in the 50s, but confocal didn't get a lot of traction until much later, like more like 70s. And then I invite you to read this paper by Wilson and Shepard when they're both back at Oxford University. So this is one of the Bibles of confocal microscopy. But it's really, in my opinion, one of the simplest imaging methods you can think of. So you focus the light down to a point, you image that point onto a pinhole, and then you scan either the object or the beam, that's it. So it's really imaging through a little hole. Now, you can do this in transmission, but it's not very practical. So let's discuss about that. So I focus the light down to a point. This is a thick object. So the major kind of advantage of confocal is that it allows you to get sectioning through thick objects. Then I have a second lens. I image this point on the detector. So notice my detector can be a point, right? Could be a photodiode, photomultiplier if you're out of signal. Okay, so you don't need a CCD. There's a version that does uses CCD, the spinning disc confocal. We'll look at that later. So the problem with this geometry, the transmission geometry, is that you have to scan the object to get the 3D image of the object. But if you do it in reflection, you can actually scan the light. And whenever you can, instead of moving the physical mass, the stage or sample or whatever, it's much easier to scan the light, which is lighter. Right? So in reflection, basically, imagine you have, oops. So the light comes in this way, it's focused down. And now, the mirror that is approximately in the Fourier plane of this lens, we're using the shift theorem. So as I tilt the mirror, this introduces e to the I kx x to my beam, right? It introduces a gradient in my phase. That's what the tilted mirror does. Passing through this lens basically gives me a shift in the point. Okay, so that's what how the galvo mirrors I want. That's how I want you to think of the galvo mirrors as operating on the shift theorem. Okay, so tilt gives you a shift, and you add another mirror on the other direction, then you scan this way. But the beautiful thing is, the light going back, it's always focusing to one point, meaning, I think in the language of microscopists, this is called descanning. So even though the beam is shifted here, by the time it went right back through this mirror and back, it's actually focusing at the same point. Which is not the case in transmission. So if I use, for example, a galvo mirror to scan this in transmission, my point is going to go up and down at the detector. while in reflection that doesn't happen. The reason it doesn't happen is that basically the light is so fast that by the time it goes back and forth, the mirror is essentially in the exact same place, even though it's doing this at, let's say, 1 kilohertz. But that's nothing with respect to the time of flight for the light. So it's finding this in the exact same position, goes back to this beam splitter, and essentially from here on, this is fixed. Doesn't know that the mirror shifted. So as you can imagine, you can use this with both fluorescence and label free or scattering. So this is an entire confocal is an entirely amplitude method. I actually invite you to think of phase contrast confocal methods. I think there's a lot of stuff that can be published there. Okay, but what that means is that if I'm looking at things like cells that are not labeled, are not fluorescent, and I'm just looking at the backscattering contrast, so I'm just collecting light scattered from here, the contrast will be very low. For the exact same reason that we discussed earlier when we introduced phase contrast microscopy, right? Because the cells do not absorb, do not even scatter a lot of light, so they're essentially phase objects. So if you only detect intensity from them, this kind of the image will have very low contrast. So it's a lot more common to use confocal with fluorescence. So the focus beam actually is the excitation beam. At the focal point, there is fluorescence that's emitted, and that's what you collect in reflection. So due to the sectioning capabilities, the confocal became very is very powerful and became very commonly used. And in the 90s, it received an upgrade with two-photon fluorescence. And we're going to talk about that a little bit later. So these are nonlinear methods where instead of exciting the fluorescent molecule with one-photon absorption, you actually use two. So through a nonlinear process. And the advantage you get there is that you can use low energy photons for the same kind of fluorescence wavelength. So instead, for example, usually you use, let's say, UV light to excite blue fluorescence. Right? So you always excite with the high energy photon. There is some non-radiative process, and then you get a radiative emission fluorescence. With nonlinear microscopy, let's say, with two-photon or three-photon fluorescence, you can combine two lower energy photons, like infrared, that combined make up the energy of a blue or UV photon, and you get the same kind of emission out. The reason it's better to excite with infrared, first of all, is that it penetrates deeper in the tissue. So you remember that for very small particles, you get the lambda minus 4 cross-section. Of course, tissue is not made of Rayleigh particles, but there is still a strong wavelength dependent that says the longer the wavelength, the less, the lower the scattering. So basically, in two-photon fluorescence, it can penetrate even deeper than with regular confocal. So that's one advantage. The second advantage is that the infrared photons are less damaging. So the probability of dissociations, like the reason we put a sunscreen block when we go into the sun, is because UV has the ability to destroy DNA. So it has the, enough energy to actually dissociate molecules. Where infrared photons do not. They interact, essentially, they convert their energy in heat, which is not to say that it's not dangerous, but it's not as dangerous. So you can set your cells on fire, but it takes a lot of energy to do that. So we're going to talk more about two-photon fluorescence later, or maybe one of you are going to present it. I don't know. So in summary, this is a very simple method in principle. It's mainly used with fluorescence. And in terms of research, most of the research in confocal has been done on how to acquire the data much faster, how to combine many different channels of fluorescence. So you can actually pay a lot of money for how simple this metal is. You can easily get the confocal for, I don't know, $300,000. And again, a lot of the research is in making it, making the acquisition very fast and combining multi-channels, like 8 different colors, for example. So there's a lot of engineering challenges to do that, as you can imagine, all the scanning and everything to be well done. Okay. Okay, so if you want to get more scientific about this, to look at the resolution, it's actually interesting that to compute the exact solution of a light distribution in the focal plane of a lens without a small angle approximation, so without the Gaussian approximation, but to calculate the exact field distribution of focal plane of a lens was not done until very recently. It required computation. This was done back in England when Emil Wolf was in England with his collaborator, and it was done just because they had the computation power somewhere in Manchester, I think. And this was such a great result that this is on the cover of Born and Wolf, which I'm sure many of you know as the Bible of optics. So it's on the cover there. Okay, so let's look at the in terms of resolution, I want you to understand one major difference between transmission and reflection. And I think I mentioned this before, but let's kind of review. Why do you get the benefit in sectioning when you're imaging reflection versus transmission? Is that immediately clear to you guys? That if I measure in reflection, I get much better sectioning than if I measure in transmission. Not clear, right? Okay. Well, let's look at the scattering problem first. Forget the fluorescence. So you are now scattering experts. You know the Born approximation. Otherwise, you'll fail the exam. So do you remember that Fourier relationship between the scattered field and the object, right? That the beauty of the Born approximation is that we have this linear relationship, this Fourier transform between the angular scattering distribution of the field versus the scattering potential or the refractive index of the object. With a little catch that the frequency is actually not k or ks, it's actually q, the momentum transfer between k incident and k scattered. So it's this q, this triangle, right? So if you remember that Ewald sphere was limiting how big this q could be, and we found that actually the biggest q I can get is when I eliminate this one, I collect exactly backwards, because that's when my q becomes 2k naught. So, if I do a transmission experiment, I get this, let's say, this scattering angle. This is the maximum, this is the numerical aperture of the objective, maximum angle. This is my Q, K incident, Ks. Q maximum gives me my triangle right here, right? 2K naught sine of theta over 2. This, I think, has something to do with your biosensors, by the way. That because it has both wavelength and angle in it. So when you're looking for resonance, they kind of both have to work together. But notice, if I'm looking on the Z component of this Q, is not very big. Right, I mean, I can make it bigger by, let's say, using a different objective, much better objective. It will be like this. So I can tilt it even more, get a bigger QZ. But still, if you compare with the reflection part, Man, is this my isosceles triangle? Jeez. Okay, imagine this and these are equal. Okay, so imagine now I focus the beam down. I have the K incident, and now I collect in scattering this way. My Q is all the way from here to here. Much bigger. Right? So you compare this versus this little thing. And notice the numerical aperture, the angle here and here are almost the same. The only difference is that this collects in transmission, this collects in reflection. Right? So the Q along Z is much bigger in reflection, and that's the reason that you have the higher frequency kind of reconstruction longitudinally or in the Z axis, which means that you are able to see a lot higher resolution in Z in reflection versus transmission. That's all. Is that kind of clear? So it's because the resolution or the highest frequency I can reconstruct from the object is encoded in Q, in the momentum transfer, the difference between incident and K scattered, and because the axial resolution relates specifically to the projection of that Q to the Z axis, it becomes very clear that actually I get a lot more QZ in reflection, so coming in this way, collecting that way, this way, collecting that way, than in transmission, where you get this little QZ projection. Yeah? So this is very important as a kind of as a concept, because there is the same lens, basically. Use the same objective in both cases, same numerical aperture, except when you look in reflection, you get a lot better section. All right. Rayleigh criterion, blah, blah, blah. You know all this. What do you guys know about adaptive optics? Nothing? Well, it's a little bit outside of our class, but basically, this was something developed first in astronomy. So try to image the stars far away. You are faced with this problem that the atmosphere is basically aberrating your system. So I think we briefly touched on aberrations, but very briefly. You can, so if this is your sample, going back to our microscope setup, and this is your Fourier plane, your aperture, P of K perpendicular, tilde, okay? All the aberrations here, meaning turbulence, or it could be your sample being embedded in some, I don't know, paraffin block that distorts the light, all those effects can be actually incorporated into a spectral phase, let's call it phase aberration, of K perpendicular. Everything. Everything there is to be known about distortions in your object can be contained into a phase term of a generic spectral phase. So, for example, when this is perfectly uniform, this is a flat, it's one. When this is equal to one, your system is perfect. What's the opposite of that? The worst system you can have is when this becomes random. It's as if I'm putting here a diffuser of some sort, right? Or I'm trying to see through very diffuse media. Why is it the worst? Because instead of having a tight focus beam, I'm going to get a speckle pattern. so I'm going to lose all the information about the object. Anyway, usual systems are in between a perfect system and this worst kind of system that you can get. So if you expand this in some series, or some people use Zernike polynomials, it's kind of, it's just an expansion. They give them names. So depending on the powers of these things. Anyway, so basically in astronomy, the problem was kind of like this. You were imaging a star from far away, and you had this atmosphere here that would generate spectral phases of some sort, which means that instead of having a very tight focal point, your star, you'll have a blur. Because as we discussed, depending on the polynomial function of this phase, you'll get anything between a very tight spot to a continuous distribution of fields, right? Okay, so what people thought was, if I could only measure this somehow, so measure that aberration, and then use a certain phase modulator, which could be liquid crystal, could be a deformable mirror, anything that allows me to change the phase at a certain plane. So I want to be able to modulate the phase versus spatial coordinate somehow and put that in the Fourier plane. So people thought, well, if I could measure this phase, the aberration phase, and somehow cancel it. So imagine, image this with a box, image this plane somewhere here, and then place a phase modulator that will do e to the minus. With an I. If I could only measure this and then put the negative of it, essentially conjugate that phase, send it back through, I'm going to get my perfect image back. And clearly, there's a reason why it's adaptive optics, because this is adapting to your, right, to the object that you're looking at. Right? So this is kind of the bottom line idea. It's a simple idea, but actually a little delicate to implement, and also fairly powerful. So what's the simplest aberration? Do you remember? What if my phase A is of the order of k perpendicular, linear in k? What does that give you? What does that do to your spatial domain? What's paraxial? Image plane will be the Fourier, let's say this is your sample plane, right? So from here to here, I have a Fourier transform. And if I have a phase term that looks like e to the I, k perpendicular, a, what's the Fourier transform of that? It's a shift. So it's going to give me whatever the transmission function, except instead of x, it's going to be shifted at a. That's exactly how the Galvo mirror works, remember? So this is really just a tilt here, which shifts the beam. Bottom line, not a terrible aberration. I can fix it, right? I mean, it's just the image is perfect, except it's shifted. Who cares? No problem. How about if your phase aberration is k squared? Yes, dispersion. But what gives you a k squared term? Come on, you know this.
Oh, out of focus.
That's our Fresnel term, right? This is basically e to the I, k squared over k squared x over f. Was no Z over F?
Z over F, I see.
No, that's it. No, that's not. So it's kx squared over f.
You need a lambda.
K naught. Right. So it's over k naught. K squared. Yeah, this is Z. Yeah. And Z gets scaled if you have magnification. Yeah. Right, so this is the Fresnel kernel. So if I'm off by Z, it will add a dish that we approximate as a Gaussian, blah, blah, blah. Is that a big aberration? No. Because it's fixable. I just shift my object and I fix it. There's no problem. The problems arise when this is of third order and worse. So all the aberrations that you heard of, I'm sure spherical aberrations and so on that you mentioned earlier, they are of third order. And if you want to be thorough about it, you go to the fifth order too. Okay, so that's what aberrations mean. So you have an adaptive instrument like a liquid crystal or deformable mirror, manage to measure the aberration by doing maybe off-axis interferometry, the kind that you did for homework, where you add the reference beam, somehow measure that, put it back on the deformable mirror, and essentially you fix it. So your image becomes sharp again. Most adaptive optics systems are not measuring the aberrations directly. They're kind of guessing it and they're doing a feedback loop. So they're modifying something, look how tight your image is, how sharp your image is, modify something on the mirror, and so on, until hopefully it converges to the right thing. There are, I think, local minima sometimes that give you trouble. A much better thing to do will be to actually measure that, as I said, maybe with an off-axis interferometer, measure that precisely, and then put it in one shot on your mirror and be done with it. But of course, that's more complicated. It means you need to make an interferometer of some sort, and you have to deal with phase measurements and so on. Okay, so if you combine adaptive optics with confocal and two-photo microscopy, actually you can get great images through very thick and kind of disturbing samples. So I've seen recently, actually, it's getting very hot. I've seen some, I was at the workshop in Germany. A lot of the talks were about this just a few weeks ago. So they're able to look through live animals, like, I don't know, zebra fish, things like that, just by essentially canceling the phase curvature in the pupil plane. Okay. If we talk about contrast in the easiest form, you want to define it as a signal of a certain structure of interest. I don't know, it could be your cell versus the background, B. And I think I mentioned this to you before, that this is not a great measure. It's too simple if you have a lot of noise in your image. Because imagine your region of interest is here, the background is here. And if you use this measure, you can get very high numbers if simply your image is noisy. So imagine you have noise everywhere. You're simply subtracting these two regions or averaging them out, you're looking at the standard deviation of the noise, basically. And that is not a good measure of your contrast, obviously. So much better is to do a contrast to noise ratio, which is taking this and normalizing it by the standard deviation of the noise. So if you have noise everywhere, you get essentially a number of 1. You know you are in bad shape, that you're at the noise level. So whenever you want to define quantitatively the contrast of your image, I suggest you use this, so normalized by the noise. And the point being that in confocal, if you just look in reflection or scattering mode without the fluorescence, you get very low contrast from transparent objects, like live cells. And that is the reason why confocal is always, almost always, fluorescence. I think I have some images or no? There we go. Look how beautiful this is. So this is wide field, this is confocal, I think, right? Yep. So you can see the effect of the confocal pinhole, right? So you see this blur on top of the wide field, so this is the full field illumination, and then this is scanning point by point with the pinhole that rejects all this light from out of focus behind and in front of the focus plane. So that's kind of the power of confocal. Yeah, I'd like to look at these beautiful images, all of them fluorescence. One thing that I wanted to point out is that speed is always an issue in confocal. So people try to use multiple beam scanning. So instead of scanning a point, imagine using some kind of a 2D diffraction grating, for example. You can split the beam into many. So you have, I've seen a Ph.D. thesis back at MIT. They were doing 8x8 beams. So now you're scanning 64 beams at a time, and therefore the range for scanning is much smaller, so it's kind of higher throughput. But there are issues with that too. One method that is somewhat common is to use a spinning disk. It's called spinning disk confocal. Your illumination is full field, but now you spin very fast a disk that has pinholes in it. Okay, so now the pinholes are distributed along the radius. So you see, if you look from the top, it looks like a spiral. So you're covering the entire field of view, but you are covering very, very fast. So in a way, now the pinhole is spinning as opposed to you scanning the beam, right? So the pinhole is covering the entire area. And at the detector, you have another pinhole here. So these two are kind of synced. So this is working well. I think it's commercially available for sure. Much faster than the regular confocal, but the sectioning is not as good. So the autofocus filtering is not as good as doing it point by point. Okay, so in summary, confocal is great, gives you that, eliminates that autofocus light for the most part, but it has limitations too, right? So its serial is slow. I mean, whenever you have to make an image out of different points, you have to scan very, very fast. It's an amplitude measurement, so it's low contrast unless you put fluorescence. It's a lot of light that you put on the sample with confocal. So compared to full field where you illuminate, let's say, with a plane wave like this, now you take all that light and you focus it into one point. So photobleaching, phototoxicity is always an issue, a high power. An interesting thing is to look into deconvolution microscopy. So basically, as you know, if you take your microscope and you put an input, the output will be input convolved with the impulse response, so the PSF. So if you know the PSF, basically, you can undo this numerically. So in the frequency domain, it's a division between the, right? So this is a product, and then you divide by the PSF, and you end up with the actual input. Apparently, this works very well, and I was surprised when the Zeiss salesperson told me is that the reason the convolution is not so, they don't sell as many deconvolution systems as the confocal is because of the speed of the numerical processing. So I'm wondering if that's still the case, because nowadays with the GPU and all these powerful computers, I think the convolutions are actually very, very fast. So you understand what it means numerically when you have a blurred image. Let's say in Z you get this blur. If you do a numerical deconvolution, essentially you numerically take the light and you put it back where it kind of diffracted from. Okay, doing that numerically. That's kind of, so I like that. It's, in a way, it's much better than what the confocal does, where it says, I'm not going to worry how this image is formed. I'm just going to cut it off. All this blur, I'm just going to put a pinhole on it and eliminate around it. The convolution is much smarter in a way, right? It's taking that and propagating back where it came from. So if it's done right, it should be higher performance than confocal. Anyway, so I think the future, computers in the future are going to play a lot more an important role in imaging. We already see that, so. Okay.